All right, Acts chapter 3 this morning. I want to look at 3 and 4, and we're going to just kind of get a few highlights here. I know it's a very, very familiar story to most of us, but as I was reading through these couple of chapters here, the thought came into my mind, what if God, you fill in the blanks, what if God granted your lifelong request? Then what would you do? A lot of times, well, it's usually ours, you got to deal with money. I mean, look, we all humans.
Yeah.
How many times we said, man, if I had so-and-so. What is so-and-so doing that I ain't doing to get what they got? Well, some of them might be working a little harder, you know? Some might have a little more favor. I don't know. God just does what he does. We have to just realize that God is God, and he gives us a lot in life, and he gives it to us for a purpose. Not everybody can have a lot of money. Not everybody can have... We all just got different gifts. I think we pretty much established that as we've been going through the New Testament in here for a few months. But what would you do if God granted you a lifelong request? Now just fill in the blank. Think about it this morning as we're setting up for this story. Now you know the story here. They have been the apostles, and they have been filled with the Holy Spirit of God. He has come and indwelt them. God's adding to the church daily such as should be saved. There's unity among the body of believers after the 50 days of just chaos going on after the burial and the crucifixion and the burial and the resurrection of our Lord. They saw the different people walking the life of the Old Testament. I mean, a lot of things going on in this church, in the life of the church, at its birth, at its early stages. So they're coming now here in chapter 3. Now Peter and John went up together into the temple at the hour of prayer, being the ninth hour. Remember, the Jewish calendar, the hour started at 6 a.m. was the new day. So it's 9 o'clock in the morning. And a certain man lame from his mother's womb was carried, whom they laid daily at the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful, to ask alms of them that entered into the temple. Now think about this man here and the story we have here of him being healed. And I'm sure this man had days of joy in his life. I'm sure there was plenty of days. Man, everything was just good. When he didn't have much pain in his legs, the sun was shining, he didn't pay much attention to his condition that he found himself in. You know, in life we have, although we may have some ailments, we have good days, we have bad days, and no matter what we find ourselves doing, but you gotta believe he had more days of discomfort, depression, pain, and got tired of having to depend on someone else to take care of him with his disability. We don't, somehow, we pass over that this man was disabled. We really do. We kind of just, oh, well, he just had a, he couldn't walk. So, but look, every day somebody laid him at this gate. Kind of like somebody we talked about in the last 5 or 6 weeks, don't we? Somebody was at the rich man's gate every day. Well, here we go. This man is laid daily at the gate. You see, even with his disability, he had legs and he had bones under his skin just like any other person. It's just that he had no strength in them. I'm sure there were days as he was laid at the gate of the temple that he would just lay there silent, looking at the people just walking about, going into the temple to pray, looking at the little kids running around and playing, their parents running and playing with them. I'm sure he would be crying out in his soul sometimes, oh God, would you just please heal me so I can do that? You know my heart's desire. So I'm asking you this time, today, what if one day God really healed you of your joint pain that you battle every day? What if God really healed you of your back pain? your high blood pressure, your diabetes, your cancer, your obesity, your depression, your addictions to prescription drugs, alcohol. You just fill in the blanks. What if this lame man, all of a sudden, unexpectedly, one day, your healing came just like it did to him? You know, he come that day, just like any other day, and he is laid at the gate. And this was a special day in his life. He didn't realize that today was going to be the day. Maybe he come expecting God to heal him. I'm not sure. And I'm sure those days of depression, he thought he was going to be in this condition for the rest of his life. Now, if you read on the end of chapter 4, you'll see this man was above 40 years old. It was not a child. This was a grown man that they come and laid at the gate. And he was battling these things. But I'm asking you, what would you do if God was to grant you this day your lifelong request? And whatever it may be. It may be wealth. Now, as I was studying this week in Ruth and looking through that, and we may be going to look at Ruth momentarily in a few studies coming up. But anyway, there happened to be a person in Ruth's line that was wealthy. You know, we want to criticize people a lot of times that has got money. But if they didn't have money, they couldn't spend money. If they didn't have money, didn't spend money, you wouldn't have no money. It's just the way it works. You got to understand that. But that man had favor. That man had wealth. And she had done went. And her husband died. And then her two sons had married two women. And then her two sons had died. And there was a famine in the land. So they had to leave. And 10 years or so went by. And they come back, yet God had somebody there prepared to change their life. I'm asking you today, can you believe God for whatever's going on in your life? This man was laid daily at this gate. And all of a sudden, one day like any other day before, this wasn't the first time Peter, James, and John went up to the temple to pray. I don't know how many times they've given him alms, given him money. I don't know. But one day his healing came. Can you really see yourself free from whatever ails you? From whatever you desire to be free from? I want to tell you, if you can't see it, you can't believe God for it, probably not going to happen. So what are you battling today? What can you believe God for? You see, the Bible talks about, well, there's no vision, what? The people perish. So what are you going to believe God for? This man, all of a sudden, this day was there, and he come by, and verse 3 says, seeing Peter and John about to go into the temple, he asked alms of them. Peter, fastening his eyes upon him with John, said, look on us. And he gave heed unto them, expecting to receive something of them. That simply tells me right there he really wasn't expecting what was supposed to happen. That's just the way God works sometimes.
Amen.
God moves through. God knows the day. The Bible teaches us to number our days. And you got to understand, in whatever situation, Brother Ricky, when we got lost over in Peru, it wasn't a fun time, was it? We was in another country. I'm talking about, you don't think you'll get robbed and thrown in the street over in Peru riding around lost, brother? They'll get you.
Quick.
We riding around, we lost. I'm talking about as a ball in high weeds, as they say. I mean, it's just blowing up. We don't know who we at. And, of course, I'm driving. Then about T-bone a police officer and get pulled over and all kind of junk went on. But we all there, I'm talking about we back, who knows where. Nobody could even tell us how to get to the airport. We could find the airport, we could have got back to the college. But anyway, we're all lost, and you know, a little emotions is going on. Maybe a little bit of panic is going on. People are starting to get, you know, a little out of hand. And I had to tell the guys, I said, look, God knew when he created this truck, created us, this day we would be lost in Arequipa, Peru. This did not slip up on him. So God knows the ending from the beginning. He knows what's going on in your life right now. He knows what you're battling. My thing is, can you see yourself delivered from whatever's going on in your life? This man really could not. Although I believe there was times in his life, he was above 40 years old. Think what's going on in your life. If you're above 40 years old, you have lived and seen a lot of things happen. Well, here he says, expecting to receive something of him. Peter said, look, man, silver and gold have I none, but such as I have, I give thee in the name of Jesus Christ, rise up and walk. And he took him by his right hand and lifted him up. And immediately his feet and ankle bones received strength. And he, leaping up and walked and entered with them into the temple, walking and leaping and praising God. Well, absolutely, I would be too. Yeah. I'm talking about if I've been lame all my life and all of a sudden, beyond my wildest expectation, God reaches down and heals me and I receive strength. And God grants me my lifelong desire, I would be walking and leaping and praising God. But you know what? On that note, God has answered a lot of prayers for us. Mm-hmm. Prayers beyond our wildest expectations. A lot of times we don't understand why we're going through what we're going through. But I'm telling you, if we will hang in there, be not weary in well-doing, and believe God for some things, and all of a sudden it'll happen. So this man, he was healed. Now we pick up the story as we go on through in verse 12 through 17 here. All right, what if you, like Peter now, had denied your Lord in the presence of others, and now you had repented and God empowered you and gave you boldness to stand and warn others about denying who Christ is? Now can you imagine? Let's read this now. All right, and I'll share with you what's the first thing that kind of went in my mind. In verse number 12, when Peter saw it, he answered the people. Now, first of all, if you'll look in chapter 4 and verse 4, you'll see that there was about 5,000 people there. That's a group of folks. Somebody had, I don't know that they was all there at the time of the healing, but they knew who this man was, and we'll see as we're going through the story. If you read on through it, we won't have time to deal with it this morning, but you'll see that they knew who this man was. So he said to all the people, you men of Israel, why marvel you at this? I mean, my goodness, I don't know about you, but I'd be marveling. I mean, you think of anybody crippled that you know. I mean, you can throw some names in your head. I just think about Leslie Ann Hutchins right now. What would I do if I, up here in church, she just got up and started walking across? Man, now would that not be a lifelong answer to prayer?
Yes, sir.
Okay, that's just an example we can relate to.
That's right.
But you see, some of you, like I was, I was addicted to drugs. I mean, I had to have my marijuana. I had to have my cocaine. I had to have my Budweiser. I had to have all that, I thought.
That's right.
Well, I'll tell you, God got to working on this old boy's heart. It really showed me that what I really needed was him. And when the connection was made and I gave my heart to Jesus, man, he just took it away. And he's done that for others. You see, there's people that's in and out of jails and in and out of hospitals, in and out of clinics, in and out of all different things because they cannot win the battle. Well, you can only do it through God. That's why we try to help people at detox and other things, that ministries that are good for people. Well, God has a way of healing people. So whatever it is, so put yourself in Peter's place here. He said, why marvel you at this, or why look so earnestly on us as though by our own power or our own holiness we made this man to walk? And the God of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, the God of our fathers, has glorified his son Jesus, whom ye delivered up and denied him in the presence of Pilate when he was determined to let him go. Now, can you imagine if you was part of this crowd, and there's no way we're going to get to it, but you'll see all over in chapter 4 how that Ananias, the high priest, was there, and Caiaphas, and John, and Alexander, all those that was there involved with the trial and the crucifixion of this were present at this place during this time. And there was about 5,000 other people there. Can you imagine being there and hearing Peter getting up talking about denying the Lord? Talking about you denying the Lord. Man, wouldn't that just make you want to bug up a little bit? Who are you, Buster, to sit here and tell me about denying God? You don't want it denied. Him. You even cursed and said you didn't know Him. Who do you think you are? Well, see, something's happened. That was a, you know, 50 days went by. Pentecost was 50. So you know 50 days went by. So that's a pretty good amount of time. I mean, we're pushing 2 months probably at this point. Maybe even a little longer. But something's happened. He's empowered and filled by the Holy Ghost of God. And you never see Peter after his filling denying his Lord again. Actually, you see just the opposite. You see things fulfilled like when he told him, he said, "Thou art Peter, and upon this rock I shall build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." Well, now you see that fulfilled. Now, do you think Peter honestly knew what Jesus was talking about when he said that? He couldn't see him as being that kind of leader, preaching with power after he denied. Especially, can you imagine him warming himself by the fire and the cock crowing 3 times? And if Jesus walks by and he has denied him, do you think he ever in his wildest dreams could look ahead and see him preaching in front of 5,000 people? And that's how many got saved at this preaching it. Amazing. So can you see beyond where you seem to be captured in? Well, he says that he denied him. But look at verse 14. "But you deny the Holy One and the Just One, and desired a murderer to be granted unto you, and kill the Prince of Life, whom God raised from the dead, whereof we are witnesses." And he goes on to talk about his name and all that. Well, and of course he done all this through the name of Jesus. So, what if you, like Peter, had denied the Lord, and all of a sudden you find yourself in a situation where you're standing before God? Well, you can do that. You can easily get so depressed, get so dependent on doctors, get so dependent on others, that you really just take Christ out of it. And there can be times when you deny Him, and all of a sudden when God has restored you, and you're back to where you ought to be, and you're growing, and you're getting on fire for God, all of a sudden you'll find yourself in situations where you gotta accept that you can't do nothing through your own, and you got to acknowledge that Jesus Christ is who He says He is, and He will use you in those situations. And if you ain't careful, that little old devil on this shoulder, you know, kind of like the devil on here and the angel on here, who do you think you are? Who do you think you are saying that? Listen. He'll even tell you who you think you are while you're on this trail down here this year. I promise you that. They're going to say, "You ain't doing nothing." Well, we ain't doing nothing. It's only the Lord doing it. But God has a way of revealing Himself to us. And the third point here in verse 18 through the end of the chapter, and there's no way we'll be able to do with it, but I want to just look at this for just a moment here. So the third thing, what would you do if God fulfilled a vision given to someone in the past right before your eyes? In this passage, the Word of God was being fulfilled in their very eyes. That's not always easy to accept because we don't believe God. We have little faith. We say, "But God, there's no way you can be doing this through me. There's no way you can use me in this capacity to fulfill your plans." Think about the thousands of years that has went by as we read this passage. "But those things which God before had showed by the mouth of all His prophets, that Christ should suffer, He has so fulfilled." How would you like to be in that day when you don't know what's going on, And they couldn't see until really plainly after the Lord, the Holy Ghost came in and dwelt them. But now they see before their eyes the scripture fulfilled. We're seeing it fulfilled today. You know, the Bible says, Jesus said there's going to be wars and rumors of wars. There's going to be earthquakes in diverse places. That's many different strange places. Y'all know it ain't been too long we had an earthquake here in Georgia. Might not have felt it. But it did register on the Richter scale. That's strange. For this part of the country, this part of the world. Well, what he say, as the days of Noah were, so shall it be in the coming of the Son of Man. They shall be marrying and giving in marriage. As the days of Sodom and Gomorrah were, so shall it be in the days of the coming of the Son of Man. You don't think we're not living in those days, you're blind. All you got to do is look around. Stuff that used to be hid and done in secret and silent is now published and pushed in your face, and you must accept it according to the world. Now look, there's a thing of tolerance, but we got to be tolerated also. You know, but we're bigots, you know, to this world. I mean, that's exactly what we are. We're a bunch of idiots. We're a bunch of hate mongers. Yeah, it's coming today, folks, and it's already happening. It ain't coming, it's here. That when you sit up and you state what thus saith the Lord, you're going to be considered a hate speecher. They're going to be coming and trying to put you in jail, trying to close shop. I mean, it's just already happening. But you know what? The Word of God is being fulfilled before our eyes. You know this phone that I got the thing plugged up to? Guess what? They can track you by this phone right now.
Yeah.
They, Verizon Wireless, somebody's probably sitting there at the computer right now. If not, they can be. And they know what I got on my screen. What's up right here as we speak. And all I got to do is go back and track it. I mean, they do phone calls. They do it all. When every eye shall see these two witnesses in the world, talking about in Revelation, it's set up. We got a barcode on everything. You know, I got a barcode scanner on this phone. I can go up to any I go up to that pack of paper towels over there. And I can scan that barcode and the product can come up. What can we, if you got your tracking device on, I can talk to you and watch you riding down the road. And I'm ignorant on this thing. I'm telling you, man, I am. A lot of y'all in here are way more bright than I am, but I'm telling you. Listen, everything is set up. The Word of God is being fulfilled in our very eyes. We need to see that. So what are we going to do? How are we going to act? Well, we must accept that. What Peter tell them here said, look, it's everything that all the prophets talked about that he should suffer has been so fulfilled. Repent, therefore, and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out. The time of refreshing shall come in the presence of the Lord. It goes on to just preach a sermon to them. Guess what happens after that sermon? A little short one. About 5,000 people got saved. So, I'm asking you, can you see yourself? If God answers your request, then what are you going to do with it? Can we believe God to do something? I said all that to say this. Think about what we're fixing to do as we go upstairs. Now, we're fixing to vote on a piece of property as members. And we're fixing to donate some money. You're not donating to the here and now. You not realize that Fred Jones, Calvin Foster, Thomas Matheny, they all sit up here one day on this hill top of this road. And this was nothing but trees. Well, there was a couple of houses there, and I know there's a couple of houses there because I'm going to tear them down and build a gym. Well, they sat up here and prayed over this, and they expected and looked forward to God doing something. Now, did they ever see what's coming up right now? No, two of them I know I mentioned in glory. But you know what? We're fixing to do something. We're going to be off. Look. I'm looking around, so that maybe Leslie in here. 15, 20 years, we off the scene, y'all.
That's right.
Serious. We're gone.
Yeah.
Now, we might be still physically alive, but we're done. You know what I'm saying? We're gone. All right? Everybody, some of y'all want to say amen to that.
Set your watches. Lord,
Jerry. We made it over. We still got plenty of time. I got time.
Check it out.
But we're laying up. We don't know what God's going to do. That's 15, right. 20 years from now.
Yes, sir.
Your grandkids. Maybe graduating from Faith Christian Academy down here.
Yeah, that's a great vision.
You don't know what God's going to do. God, I'm telling you, God is working things out. And one day it happens. So what are you going to do when you find yourself in the middle of what God has given the vision to somebody else? So just think about it. Father, thank you for your words this morning. Pray that it be a help to someone. God, just glorify your name now in Jesus' name. Amen.